We will start this week talking about freedom from human rules, which is just saying about how others conduct themselves or want us to live. But before we get into that, let's review week four, what we talked about last week. In light of who Christ is, all he has done for us and has given us, the believer's main characteristic should be a heart of gratitude to God. That should be the mode of operation for everything that we do and how we think. If we put Jesus Christ first in everything we do, we will have discernment to filter out the things that can captivate us from the world. The Holy Spirit is the only voice I need to listen to. And we talked about how that's even crept into the church. Things like politics, things like conspiracy theories, things about podcasts and Christian celebrities and you know, people that might have good, can be used for good, but it also can be a distraction. It can be something that can come in and takes our focus away from Christ. So we have to make sure we don't get captivated by those things. We also talked about the certificate of debt, and in that culture, this was an agreement between two parties. It was usually like an indentured servant kind of situation, where it was someone who could not sustain themselves monetarily, and so they would, for you know, provisions, they would work that off, and it would be an agreement for a certain amount of time, for a certain amount of money, but usually it was just to work off what they had been given. So Paul used that as an example of, let me back up, there was also a penalty to be paid if that agreement had not been met. Very much like a loan would be in our society now, but again, it was a personal, like indentured thing. So it was a person's life, but Paul uses this to use it as a picture of Christ paid our debt. He canceled that certificate of debt, and he destroyed it. And then not only that, are we not indebted anymore because of the sin, but he gave us freedom in him, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. And then again, we should walk around with a heart of gratitude because of all this that we talked about. So let's get into chapter 2, verses 16 through 23. And really, it's starting to talk about the liberty that we have in Christ. I'm going to break these verses down, and then we will take them one by one. So verse 16 says, "Therefore, do not let anyone judge you with respect to food or drink, or in the matter of a feast, new moon, or Sabbath days." Paul is continuing to build his case. He's laid that foundation, but he's saying the therefore. Therefore is huge because it's referring back to all we've talked about for the last 4 weeks in the verses before this. In the Greek, the word therefore means to show what ought now to be done by reason of what has been said to this point. So there is a purpose in therefore. This has been said, now this needs to happen. That's what that's meaning. And here's what he's referring to when he says therefore. Remember who Christ is. Remember who we are in him, and don't be caught up in deceitful philosophies. And Paul wanted the Colossians to have confidence because of what he has taught them so far. There's no other voices that need to influence us. And for those of us at the Oasis, if you were here last Sunday or you watched the live cast, Jeff's message was all about having confidence in Christ. So God really is chasing us with a message, and I think it's time to sit up and take notice. He wants us to be confident in who we are in him, who he is, how he wants to lead us and guide us. And this is what Paul was trying to teach the Colossians as well. So there will be people, even Christians, who will cast judgment on us, people who unfairly find fault with this or that in others, things like, he says in this verse, food and drink. Now that's self-explanatory. We don't need to be in judgment of what others eat and drink. And judgment, we will talk about the definition of that in just a few minutes, but judgment is different than coming alongside someone who might be in the sin of, say, gluttony or drunkenness that's a different category. We're just talking about your preferences versus my preferences versus, you know, what we are convinced is good for us, in that we don't have to be judgmental of each other in that. Then also he talked about feasts, which were festivals or holy days. Now the Jews marked themselves separate from pagans by celebrating various festivals and even the Sabbath. And Paul's argument was not in opposition of these various observances, but rather to say they were not to be the emphasis. We talked about in our study of Genesis and Exodus, obviously these were things handed down from God to the Jews to remember him by, but they were and are not to be legalistic about them, so we should not be either. A couple cross-references. Romans 14:5 says, one person regards one day holier than other days, and another regards them all alike. Each must be fully convinced in his own mind. Galatians 5:13 says, if you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity to indulge your flesh, but through love serve one another. So he is already setting it up that we need to understand we have freedom in Christ, confidence in Christ, and others, including outside false philosophies, should not come in and knock us off course for that. In verse 17, he goes on to say, these are only the shadow of the things to come. He's talking about those feasts and those observances. But the reality is Christ. So a couple of definitions from the original language. Shadow is an image cast by an object and representing the form of the object. It's equivalent to a sketch or an outline. So understand, if you cast a shadow, depending on the time of day, it can be a perfect image of you, it can be long, it can be short, it can be warped, stretched out of proportion. In 1 Corinthians 13:12, it says, where we only see a blurred reflection in a mirror. Paul uses different, and that's Paul talking as well in 1 Corinthians. There are different ways to say that we cannot fully see who Christ is through these observances. They are only shadows. There's a purpose in them. It's okay to remember him that way, but they are not the reality. Christ is the reality. Our relationship with Christ is the reality. So all of these things, feasts, traditions, holy days, only represent Christ. He and a relationship with him is the real deal, not the shadow. So let's use some examples. Christmas, a celebration of Christ's coming, but there are many trappings and distractions. And in my own household, I am a Christmas person. I cannot wait. The day after Thanksgiving, I start. Jeff is more of that, you know what, all days unto the Lord, and I'd be all right if we don't get all up in the air about all this stuff. But we have come, after 39 years of marriage, we have come to a place where he's fine with it. He enjoys that. And I also respect that he's not going to get overly excited about it either. We can coexist that way, understanding that there's nothing right or wrong about either way. You just allow the other person that. These might be a little bit trite examples, but I think they're good examples. Sundays, the day of rest or Sabbath. I'm not talking about the assembling of ourselves. This is when we do set aside. So that's another category of we should still be part of the body together and get together. But Sundays as the day of rest or Sabbath, as a lot of people will think of it, that's a principle that we're commanded to practice. But again, shouldn't be legalistic about it. There are people who have to work their jobs on Sunday. My own husband works his job on Sunday. He doesn't get a day of rest that way. But again, we have to be careful that we do observe what God has asked us to do, because especially in today's society, we can forget that altogether, but not be legalistic about when it happens, both for ourselves and for others. So the key to this part of the passage is relax. Relax for yourself and relax about what others do, because understanding that we all have that personal walk with Christ. So then in verse 18, It says, "Let no one who delights in false humility and the worship of angels pass judgment on you." That person goes on at great lengths about what he has supposedly seen, but he is puffed up with empty notions by his fleshly mind. So this is speaking of people who take more pleasure in speculating about and concentrating on the heavenly beings than God. This was something that they practiced and they paid attention to and thought more about, I think, than what I would say we do today. They try to play it off as humble, but it becomes ostentatious, as insincere, pious. And then they go on and on about their visions to the extent that they become proud and intrusive as they pass judgment on others. So think about like this. If you pass judgment, these are some definitions, and I'm going to give them to you slowly and even repeat them. Definitions of passing judgment. They defraud you of your prize. This is what someone who passes judgment does. Decide to umpire against you. Declare you unworthy of a prize. And they even defraud you of the prize of victory itself. I'll repeat those. Defrauding you of your prize. Decide to umpire against you. Declare you unworthy of a prize. And defraud you of the prize of victory itself. Now, when he's talking about not necessarily what they were passing judgment about, but I would say liken it to today into our version of Holy Spirit experiences. There are people who are so in tune with the Holy Spirit that they would tell you they hear from the Holy Spirit regularly, and some of us might not feel so much that way. But we cannot consider what God might reveal to us more special than someone else's insights from God. Remember that. Any experience or vision must line up with God's word and not harm the body. And especially remember that the word of God is still the primary way God speaks to his children. So even though there is a place for those experiences, those are part of our personal walk. And while I think those are valid, remember, anything that's of God will either bring him glory and or build up the body. And if it does neither of those things, probably ought to revisit that and check yourself. So far, let me back up. In the Amplified Version, I'd like to read this verse to you because I like the way it really spells it out. Let no one defraud you of your prize, which is your freedom in Christ and your salvation, by insisting on mock humility and worship of angels, going into detail about visions that he claims he has seen to justify his authority, puffed up in conceit by his spiritual mind. So far, Paul is saying, don't let others pass judgment on you, and do not judge others either. He now segues slightly into our roles and responsibilities in Christ's body, because it's important for us to, that's another layer on the foundation that he's been laying, not to treat others that way, and don't let others treat you that way. In verse 19, he says, he has not held fast, and he's talking about the person who passes judgment. He has not held fast to the head from whom the whole body, supported and knitted together through its ligaments and sinews, grows with a growth that is from God. In the New Living Translation, it reads, they are not connected to Christ, the head of the body. For he holds the whole body together with its joints and ligaments, and it grows as God nourishes it. Now, I don't know that I would go so far as to say that this is talking about someone can't be saved if they're judgmental, because I know I can be judgmental. And I'm assured of my salvation, and I think you would feel the same way. It's more of we're not connected, as in walking, surrendered to, listening and obeying the head. That's more how I take he is referring to that. So he's still speaking about those whom Paul is giving the warning. He reminds the Colossians that these people are just all about themselves. But the goal is unity and cohesiveness in the body. And that's what he's referring to when he's talking about those ligaments. We are to all be joined together to Christ, the head of the body. Through bonds and connections, which are the joints and ligaments, which need to be forged. We don't, as the church body, have the privilege of being born all together like a newborn baby and just grow in that. We come in and have to hook ourselves in with someone's, and become part of that. Let's think about it. What does that look like for you? Are you connected at the Oasis? What joint or ligament are you attached to? Because those are the moving parts. You can be a part of the body and you still have a joint or ligament or both maybe attached to you, because that is what attaches you to the other parts of the body, if you think about it. But those can also become strained and injured as well. And I want to give you an example. I have a thumb that has been hurting me for weeks. And I finally went to my wonderful chiropractor and he said, it's not really your thumb, it's a piece in your back that you've injured somehow. And it's the part, guess what, that pinches off what comes down into my arms and hands. So this is hurting, but this was hurt. And I think, man, that's a great example of how we as a body ought to be. Now, my leg is not bothered by that. So I think that's a reminder of, we can come into this room and be hooked in, but you're not going to be hooked into everyone. That's unrealistic. But you should be hooked into some part of the body, the part that complements you and that you work well together and that you can serve the Lord together, if that makes sense. So, but when my thumb started, well, actually, when my back got hurt, my thumb felt it because they're connected. That's what the body is really supposed to be. And if we're not feeling that, question if you're really connected, if you are really part of what the bigger body is, and to the point of being functional, if that makes sense, service, and where you can just speak into someone else's life because you have that connection. So I hope that makes sense. In verse 20, moving on, if you have died with Christ to the elemental spirits of the world, why do you submit to them as though you lived in the world? The New Living Translation says it this way. If you have died with Christ, and he has set you free from the spiritual powers of this world, so why do you keep on following the rules of the world? So a couple definitions again from the original language. Died with Christ is referring to my relation with something that has passed away. I'm putting off all sensibility to worldly things that draw me away from Christ. Here's Paul repeating again. We just looked at that in verses, chapter 2, verse 8 last week. He's repeating it, reminding them. And the powers of this world are the rulers and the principalities that we've talked about as well. And submitting to, don't miss this, is literally allowing rules to be imposed on me. So if I submit to the elemental spirits and these world rules that others are imposing on me, I am allowing that. Remember who you are and whose you are. Freedom, not rules. And please keep that in its context of what we're talking about when we're talking about other people. You got to keep focused on Christ, not on other people. Then in the last section for tonight, chapter 2, verses 21 through 23. This is a quote of some of the things that maybe others would say. Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These are all destined to perish with use, founded as they are on human commands and teachings. Even though they have the appearance of wisdom with their self-imposed worship and humility achieved by an unsparing treatment of the body, a wisdom with no true value, they in reality result in fleshly indulgence. Hear now these do nots that increase in specificity and ridiculousness, because it's a downward scale. Handle, when he says do not handle, is a general abstinence. Don't adhere to that. Taste means don't take nourishment from or take it in, ingest it. Touch is obviously, don't even lay a finger on it. Do you hear how the restrictions keep coming down and coming down? These are the things that others want to tell us. They want to restrict us. And Paul is using the language that shows that. In general, these doctrines are devised by man as misuses and abuses and are destined for corruption and destruction. They don't end up accomplishing anything. They may look good, but they are in reality what amounts to a counterfeit religion being paraded in false humanity and merely gratifying the human nature. It might feel good to beat yourself into submission or say, I didn't do that or I don't do that. But if that's not coming from God, it's worthless. It doesn't mean anything. How would these things that we've talked about tonight affected the church? How about corporate worship? If you have people coming in with that condescension of, hey, I got the spirit and you don't, not so much, and then others coming in with, ugh, I don't measure up because I'm not getting what they're getting, how is that a unified corporate worship? It's not. We come in and we are divided before we ever start. These are the reasons why Paul is wanting us to grasp these and start putting them into effect. The bonds and connections would not be strong. We'd have the haves and the have-nots. We'd have pride and elevated insights, condescension. And then not only that, but outside influences and regulations have been brought in. Man-made rules have crept in to what should be worship for Jesus Christ alone. God gives us what he does to bring us together in humility, not cause us to be prideful. Again, everything is with his body in mind. We have diversity, of course. We're all different, but we're always striving to be unified. There's a difference. We can be different and still all be on the same page, if you would. We must be willing to sacrifice for the good of the whole. And in today's vernacular, it's not about me. I should come in here wanting to worship Christ and serve my brothers and sisters. Do I get a blessing out of that when I do it? Absolutely. But that's not the focus. That's not my goal coming in. It should be Jesus and then others. What part am I in the body? What part do I play? So, keeping this in mind will help us put next week's lessons in proper perspective, because then Paul gets really practical in how we should treat one another. It's not about the do nots, it's about what we should be doing. So I'm looking forward to that and in the weeks ahead as well. So let's pray before we end the night. Father, I just thank you for your word. Lord, thank you for this letter. And Lord, how it has brought our focus into you and putting you first in all things. We do just need Christ alone. Lord, thank you for the repeated message, because Lord, we need to be reminded over and over again, not just who you are, but who you have given us freedom to be in you. So Father, help us to practice that this week, and Lord, help us to remember that you should be our focus in all that we do and say. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.